I'm very thankful to Professor Dr. Ines Shentout for inviting me. In the beginning, I'm very thankful to Professor Dr. Ines Shentout for inviting me to this international conference. In the beginning, I am honored to be here in this 15th International Conference of the Arabic Association for the Study of Diabetes. I would like to thank Professor Dr. Ines Shentout for inviting me to participate with this presentation with you here today. And I'm also very thankful to the Scientific and Organizing Committee of the conference for preparing such a successful conference. The topic I'm going to, I would like to present myself. I am Alia Aider Abdel Fattah, Associate Professor of Psychiatry with particular interest in old age psychiatry. And today, the topic that I'm going to discuss today is Alzheimer's, dementia, and diabetes, exploring the relation between both. In the beginning, I would like to inform you of some facts about Alzheimer's dementia. So the first thing is concerning the prevalence rates and the epidemiology of Alzheimer's disease. The overall prevalence rate of dementia is 5% at 65 years of age. This 5% tend to double every 5 years increase in age until it reaches 20% at 80 and 40% above 85. Alzheimer's disease represents 50 to 70% of all kinds of dementia. And accordingly, it is the commonest type of dementia, and it is very much age-related. Alzheimer's disease is slightly more common in women than men, especially above the age of 80. The prevalence rates are higher in developing countries. As we see from this slide, we have 50 million patients suffering from dementia all over the world in 2018. This number is expected to double by 2030 and reach 82 million patients of dementia worldwide. This slide here shows the top 10 global causes of death in 2016, according to the WHO. As we can see from this slide or from this diagram, Alzheimer's dementia ranks 5th, and diabetes ranks 7th leading cause of death. And moreover, Alzheimer's dementia is the only disease among these diseases which cannot be prevented, cannot be delayed, or cured. Moreover, 80% of patients suffering from Alzheimer's dementia have comorbid diabetes or metabolic syndrome. 1 in 10 American adults suffer from diabetes. If this trend continues, the number of people with diabetes is expected to double or triple by 2050. 80% of people suffering from Alzheimer's disease have insulin resistance or type 2 diabetes. So as we see, there's a very high comorbidity between both of them and very high prevalence of both of them. I would like to begin introducing some facts about dementia in general and Alzheimer's disease in particular. So when we are talking about dementia, we usually use the term dementia to describe an umbrella of disorders. These disorders are disorders that are associated with significant cognitive decline. Among the causes of dementia, there are neurodegenerative causes, there are vascular causes, and there are other causes. The neurodegenerative causes, the commonest one of them is Alzheimer's disease. 70% of all dementias are Alzheimer's disease. Other neurodegenerative pathologies which are less common include Lewy body dementia, Parkinson's dementia, frontotemporal dementia, and others. The second most common cause of dementia is the vascular dementia. It accounts for 20% of all causes of dementia. And when we speak of vascular dementia, we mean that there should be cerebrovascular pathology in the brain. This cerebrovascular pathology usually is a strategic infarct. And when I speak of a strategic infarct, I mean that there are infarctions in the areas that are responsible for cognition. And these areas are usually the parietal, temporal lobe, or superior frontal lobe in the dominant hemisphere. The other cause of vascular dementia is the white matter disease. And in order for the white matter disease to cause dementia, it should affect at least 25% of the white matter of the brain. Other causes of reversible dementias account for 10 to 15%. The reversible dementias, although not common, but are very important. And their importance comes from the fact that they are highly reversible upon treatment of the underlying cause, while the other dementias, the neurodegenerative and vascular dementias, are not reversible at all. So when I'm speaking of the reversible dementias, I mean, for example, normal pressure hydrocephalus, trauma, alcohol-induced dementia, vitamin deficiency, hypothyroidism, and many others. This slide shows the different factors that are involved in the etiology of Alzheimer's dementia. And among the most important factors are aging and genetics. They are the most important factors in the development of Alzheimer's disease. And as we see from this slide, Alzheimer's dementia is multifactorial and complex, where genetic factors, age, advancing age, and vascular risk factors play an important role. Other factors include environmental factors, sedentary life, smoking, diet, unhealthy lifestyle, lack of exercise, and so on. When I'm speaking of Alzheimer's dementia and dementia in general, I would like to introduce to you the continuum of Alzheimer's disease and how the course of Alzheimer's disease proceeds. So the first thing is the underlying brain pathology, which usually starts several years before the onset of symptoms. And then cognitive decline starts with mild symptoms that can be compensated and do not affect the functions of daily living, which is the so-called mild cognitive impairment. And then dementia sets in. The typical course of dementia shows a gradual onset with a steady decline along the years, with an average number of years from 2 to 8 years. I would like also to share with you the common presentations of Alzheimer's dementia. So in the beginning, usually the symptoms start with memory difficulties, and the memory difficulties usually start with inability to recall recent events, and then the affection of other cognitive functions, and the other cognitive functions affected are usual, the language functions, word finding difficulties, difficulties in decision making, in planning, in time management, and visuospatial and dimensional problems, and then activities of daily living are affected, so the patient would start showing difficulty in doing the usual activities of his daily life. For example, driving, handling money, working, household activities, and others. And then mood changes and anxiety start to set in, and the mood changes and anxiety symptoms account for 30 to 40% of patients suffering from Alzheimer's disease. They suffer from depression, they suffer from anxiety. And usually, it usually happens in the first, in the early stages and middle stages of dementia, and is usually related to the awareness of the patient of the deficits, the cognitive deficits that he is suffering from, and his inability to compensate for these deficits. This is followed by sleep problems, and sleep problems happen in 80% of patients suffering from Alzheimer's disease. And the sleep problems are usually irregular sleep-wake times, excessive daytime fatigue, and others. Finally, the behavioral manifestations start to set in. We see some patients in the middle and late stages of dementia suffering from agitation, suffering from suspiciousness, worries. The suspiciousness usually stems from the problems, the cognitive problems, and the memory difficulties that the patient has, so he cannot remember where his money is, where his belongings are. So the first thing that comes to his mind is that somebody has taken his things, and the suspiciousness and the delusion of theft is the common type of delusion in patients suffering from Alzheimer's dementia. Finally, orientation problems, gait problems, bladder problems, bowel problems, feeding problems. These are facts about Alzheimer's dementia. This slide shows the pathology of Alzheimer's dementia. So under normal circumstances, we have the amyloid precursor protein gene. If it is completely normal, the amyloid in the brain will normal cleavage of the amyloid protein will happen by the gamma secretase and by the alpha secretase, and it will be divided into two parts that are highly soluble, and they are removed from the brain through the CSF. Under other circumstances, if the patient has abnormalities in the amyloid precursor protein gene, he is genetically susceptible to develop Alzheimer's disease or other problems involving some genes like the presenilin gene 1 or 2. He has abnormalities in the beta secretase or the gamma secretase enzymes, which will divide the amyloid precursor protein in an improper or unequal cleavage, which will result in the development of the insoluble 42A beta amyloid. This insoluble 42A beta amyloid cannot be removed by the CSF, and it will accumulate in the brain. It will lead to the development of amyloid plaques all over the brain. It will accumulate around the cell, and this will invite an inflammatory reaction. This inflammatory reaction will lead to affection of the function of the nerve cell, in addition to hyperphosphorylation of a microtubule inside the neuron, which is called the microtubule, which leads to the development of what is called the tau protein. So we have the pathology of Alzheimer's is the amyloid tau hypothesis, and the abnormal phosphorylation of the tau will in turn lead to the development of tau deposited in the brain. So we have amyloid outside the nerve cell. We have tau inside the nerve cell. The nerve cell cannot function properly. The nerve cell eventually dies, and this leads to the degeneration and the atrophy which occurs in Alzheimer's disease. This is an autopsy, a healthy brain compared to advanced Alzheimer's disease. A coronal section, and as we can see, the atrophy, especially in the temporal and parietal regions, especially in the hippocampal areas, which are the areas responsible for memory, widening of the sulci, dilatation of the ventricles, and the areas affected are the areas responsible for memory, language, and complex activities like decision making. This is a PET scan and a positron emission tomography scan of the brain, and this is the so-called amyloid and tau PET scan. It is a PET scan which uses a radioactive tracer that is specially detecting the deposits of amyloid and tau in the brain. And as we can see here, the scan shows higher accumulation of amyloid and tau in the temporal and parietal regions of the brain of the patients suffering from Alzheimer's. Here we are going to speak of about the common and the shared risk factors in the development of Alzheimer's, dementia, and diabetes. So they both have common risk factors. Among these common risk factors which may lead to the development of both is the inflammation, oxidative stress, increased advanced glycation in the products, impaired insulin signaling, and accordingly, type 2 diabetes increase the pathology of Alzheimer's disease. And type 2 diabetes increase the risk of cerebrovascular disease and the accumulation of advanced glycation in products. And more than 70% of patients with Alzheimer's dementia show evidence of vascular pathology on MRI scan, vasculopathy, and white matter disease. So according to this diagram, we can see the interaction which happens between Alzheimer's disease and diabetes, and how both of them tend to aggravate the pathology of the other. This is another slide which shows the common interactions between the diabetes and Alzheimer's disease. So as we can see here, there are certain factors like the genetic vulnerability, the environmental factors, which increase the possibility of developing type 2 diabetes. And In turn, it also increases the possibility of development of brain insulin resistance or brain insensitivity, which happens in the brain of patients suffering from Alzheimer's. So as we can see here, type 2 diabetes increases through the inflammation, through the hyperinsulinemia, through the microvascular disease, oxidative stress, advanced glycation end products. All of this increase the pathology, the deposition of amyloid plaques and tau inside the brain of patients. Moreover, the brain insulin resistance increases this pathology as well through the increased activity of the glycogen synthetase kinase enzyme. It's also well known that it was thought before that the brain did not contain, that the brain was completely insulin insensitive. Now it is well known that the brain contains insulin and insulin growth factor 1 receptors, and that these receptors are located in the hippocampus and the medial temporal lobes and the hypothalamus and the amygdala. And these areas in particular are the areas which play important role in cognition and behavior and also in metabolic regulation, which links the two disorders together. And now the question is, based on what all the information that I have previously mentioned, can we consider Alzheimer's disease as type 3 diabetes? Although the neurons possess mechanisms for glucose influx that are not dependent on insulin, research shows that in certain brain areas, the areas that are responsible for cognition mainly, like the hippocampus, hypothalamus, insulin has an effect on glucose uptake. Some studies have shown that insulin is involved also in long-term potentiation, and long-term potentiation is responsible for memory. Other studies have shown that it also may regulate the level of other neurotransmitters in the brain. The downstream effectors and mediators of insulin may reduce the accumulation of tau in the brain. Peripheral insulin resistance may be partly responsible for decreased insulin transport through the blood-brain barrier. And here I'm going to discuss with you the most recent studies that have investigated the relation between Alzheimer's disease and diabetes. And I'm going to speak of animal studies. I'm going to speak of studies which were done on patients suffering from diabetes or metabolic syndrome, studies which were done in patients suffering from both Alzheimer's disease and diabetes, and finally, drug trials which have tried the use of insulin and other anti-diabetic agents as a treatment in patients with Alzheimer's disease, non-diabetic patients with Alzheimer's disease. So this study entitled Insulin Signaling in the Hippocampus and Amygdala Regulates Metabolism and Neurobehavior. It was published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science of the United States of America in February 2019. The study used adult mice in which the insulin receptors and the insulin growth factor 1 receptors were inactivated in the hippocampus and the central amygdala. This resulted into lower levels of glutamate AMPA receptors, and the glutamate is a main excitatory neurotransmitter in the brain, which is responsible for memory and learning. The mice displayed increased anxiety behavior, impaired cognition, metabolic abnormalities, and glucose intolerance. As we can see here from this slide, there is here a comparison between the mice, the knockout mice, were compared to the control mice. There is a difference, a very big difference in the ability of the mouse, in the time taken by the mouse for object recognition and object location, and the number of errors when we compare the two, the control mouse and the knockout mouse for these receptors, which again confirm the role of these receptors in these particular areas in regulation of cognition and behavior in addition to metabolism as well. This is many studies were done on diabetic patients trying and patients suffering from metabolic syndrome and patients suffering from insulin resistance, trying to answer the question whether these patients show greater cognitive impairment or greater cognitive decline when compared to others. And the answers to all these studies are diabetes is associated with higher and accelerated risk of cognitive decline. Adequate glycemic control in diabetes may be associated with slower rate of cognitive decline and slower progression to dementia. And again, the question is, adequate glycemic control in diabetic patients, which anti-diabetic medications, insulin, other anti-diabetic medications, is associated with the lower risk of development of incident dementia. Many studies tried to answer this question. All of them gave contradictory information concerning the role of insulin and other antidiabetics in reducing the risk of development of dementia in diabetic patients. Some studies showed that individuals with diabetes treated with insulin had a substantially greater risk for developing Alzheimer's dementia. And this possibly could be understood in terms of the fact that patients who are controlled by insulin are usually severe when compared to patients who receive oral hypoglycemic medications. By contrast, another neuropathological study reported that individuals treated with insulin and oral antidiabetics had lower neurotic plaque density than individuals without diabetes. Another study reported that metformin reduced phosphorylation of tau. Metformin was also found to improve impaired neuronal insulin signaling and Alzheimer's disease-related neuropathological changes in another recent study. These findings suggest that metformin may play a role in reducing the risk of Alzheimer's, while other studies failed to find this association, and some of them even went to say to mention that the metformin use could increase the generation of beta amyloid protein in the brain. So we have contradictory information about which antidiabetic drug that could reduce the risk of incident dementia.
Thank you.